From the grave. Dracula, the most fearsome name in any language, the most feared being ever to haunt the living.
Must never be left alone.
Bring her to me!
Christopher Lee, Rupert Davies, Veronica Carlson, Hammer's new star discovery, Dracula's most beautiful victim. Dracula has risen from the grave. To resist him is useless. To rise against him is futile. To know him is eternal damnation. Dracula has risen from the grave.
Greetings everyone, this is Michael yet again, and welcome back to another video. Continuing my look at the classic horror films from the legendary film company Hammer Studios. And I just saw another one about a week ago, guys. And as always, I mean to get these videos out a little bit faster, but I cannot do it. But anyway, today's film is actually another Dracula movie. And if you've been following this series so far, guys, you realize that I have been reviewing all the Hammer Dracula horror films. I'm starting at the beginning and working my way down in the franchise. But today's film is actually one that stars, once again, Christopher Lee. And the name of the movie, now of course you guys already know, but the name of the film is Dracula Has Risen from the Grave. And this one followed Dracula, Prince of Darkness. And I actually had Dracula Has Risen from the Grave on my four film favorites here that was put together by Warner Brothers. And this has, of course, four films on it. And Horror of Dracula. Then we have the second film on this collection that I'm reviewing. There's two more on it that I haven't got to yet. But Dracula Has Risen from the Grave. And there it is right here, guys. And it's kind of a strange looking cover if you really think about it. I mean, you know, this is Christopher Lee, supposedly, in a purplish makeup. And this was actually, I believe, the poster used by Warner Brothers when the film was brought to the States. But there you have it. Dracula Has Risen from the Grave. And this, of course, I've shown this off before. The discs are pretty bland. They look like this. There's nothing on them at all. And it's kind of sad because they could have did so much more with it. And this one's actually missing a disc. It's still in the Blu-ray player. But Dracula Has Risen from the Grave. Get the glare off of it. There we go. Now, this is a film, guys, that I think I only saw this film one time when I was a kid. And this was actually one of those rare Hammer films that they didn't show a whole lot of. I didn't see a whole lot of this one. And when I really think about it, I think that the film that they showed the most out of any of the Hammer horror films, at least when I was a kid, the ones I remember the most are Horror of Dracula and The Brides of Dracula. Those are the only two that I remember seeing repeatedly on television. And I didn't watch them all the times that I saw it repeated, but I definitely remember seeing them being repeated. Now, of course, guys, this film stars Christopher Lee. And then we have Marion Mathy, Rupert Davies, Veronica Carlson, Barbara Ewing, Ewan Hooper, and Barry Andrews. Dracula, Prince of Darkness was a hit in the UK, and it was also a hit in the US. Now, granted, it wasn't a huge hit that Hammer Studios wanted it to be. I mean, is any film ever the huge hit that any studio wants it to be? But it did make some money. And when it came time for another film, another sequel in the franchise, Warner Brothers had decided that they would fully finance the film for Hammer. So this gave them pretty much artistic license over the film and who would appear in the film. Now, when it came time to cast the role of Dracula, Hammer Films did not want to use Christopher Lee. And I know you guys are thinking, well, you know, what's the point? If we're going to make a Dracula film, why aren't we going to use Christopher Lee? Well, they didn't want to use Christopher Lee. And a lot of that had to do with the fact that Christopher Lee and the executives at Hammer, the production people, the filmmakers, throughout history, it's been said that Christopher Lee was not the easiest actor to work with. Apparently, you know, he was really outspoken. He said what was on his mind. If you think that I'm going to say any of this dialogue, you're very much mistaken. I mean, you know, the man spoke what he had to say. He didn't hold back. And that kind of rubbed a few people at Hammer the wrong way. Now, when that got back to Warner Brothers, oh no, Warner Brothers was like, no, no, no. We are not going to finance this film if Christopher Lee is not in it. As a matter of fact, we demand that Christopher Lee be in this film because he's the appeal of the Dracula movies. So that kind of swayed Hammer's interpretation of the film. They decided to work it out with Christopher Lee. Now, of course, Christopher Lee wanted a little bit more money than he got from the last film. And, you know, that's understandable. You know, every film that comes after a previous film, you know, the actors are usually paid more money. But Hammer succumbed to Lee's demands, gave him what he wanted, and he made an appearance in Dracula Has Risen from the Grave. Now, one thing that distinguishes this film from the other films in the Dracula franchise is that this was the first movie to not be directed by Terence Fisher. And as a matter of fact, everyone, it was directed by a guy named Freddie Francis, who was a two-time Academy Award-winning cinematographer. You can definitely see a difference in the filming style of Terence Fisher and Freddie Francis. And a lot of people over the years have wondered just why Terence Fisher didn't direct this film. And there's two main reasons that have been passed around throughout history. Some people believe this reason, some people believe that reason. But the first reason is that Terence Fisher was out on a drinking binge. He was unable to direct. He was unable to work. He was just basically, for lack of a better word, a drunk. He just couldn't get to the job. And then another one, another common theory, or not a theory, but another reason is that Terence Fisher had injured himself in an accident and broken his leg, and he was unable to direct. Now, I tend to believe the latter, that Fisher had a leg accident, broke his leg. And, you know, a lot of times people want to make some drama out of things that's not really there. It's a lot simpler to say, oh, he broke his leg, but a lot of times people want to create some tension and drama and say, oh, he's a drunk, he didn't show up, yeah, he was throwing up everywhere. But I don't believe that story at all, guys. I believe that Fisher was actually injured in an accident and was unable to direct. But the show must go on, as they say, and Freddie Francis was given the directorial reins over the film. Now, I had mentioned to everyone that, you know, there is a distinct difference in the way the film looks compared to Terence Fisher, who has more of a gothic kind of vision in the films. Now, the main difference to me in this film is that Freddie Francis brings a lot of his filmmaking techniques, his cinematography techniques to the film itself. He uses a lot of color gel lenses to enhance the film, as far as whenever Dracula's on screen, you get these certain hues that really never change when he's on screen. They're kind of like a marker, a residence of his evil, highlighted by the colored lenses that Freddie Francis uses in the film. And I think it's to really good effect. It's definitely, at the time, very, very different and very, very unique. And I thought it played very, very well on screen, just really kind of beautiful to look at. And as a matter of fact, the DVD copy that I have of the film is a very, very pristine copy, and it looks very, very good. So that's really the major difference in terms of the cinematography itself. Now, the previous Dracula films had been filmed at the Bray Studios. So you had Dracula's castle, you had a nice road and a nice moat leading up to the castle and all that. Now, when Freddie Francis took over, they were no longer filming the movies at Bray Studio, and they actually filmed it at Elm Street Studio. So, and I gotta say that I like the Bray Studios better, because just the locations and, you know, the physical things like the moat and the road and all that just seemed a lot more realistic and believable. And when they switched to Elm Street, they did not have that at all. And it even translates into the movie. Because, you know, we've had three films before Dracula Has Risen to the Grave, or Risen from the Grave. And one of the things that's interesting about it is that, you know, in the previous films, they were always able to travel a road to Dracula's castle. As a matter of fact, this was a big deal in Prince of Darkness, when, you know, these people were just taking this carriage up to Dracula's fortress. Now, here comes Dracula Has Risen from the Grave, and the road is no longer there. The moat is no longer there. As a matter of fact, the moat that Dracula succumbed to in the last film, this big running water moat, is actually this little bitty stream by the time we get to Dracula Has Risen from the Grave. And what's interesting is that, you know, in the film, in the screenplay, two characters have to travel to Dracula's castle. And it's in the Carpathian Mountains, but in the previous films there was a road to get there, but in this movie the road is just mysteriously gone. Even though we have the same town And basically, we should have the same layout to get there. But in this film, the road is gone, and two of the characters have to climb mountains to get to Dracula's castle. I mean, actual mountains. So when they switched to Elm Street Studios, there's definitely a big difference, and they didn't have the locations and all that that they had with Bray Studios. And other than the gel colors, which I thought were used to great effect, the film wasn't as lavish as the previous films with the big open sets and the big just elaborate homesteads and all that. But one thing that the film did do very, very well is that it had some really exquisitely painted and detailed matte paintings. And I'm looking at these matte paintings and I'm just thinking, you know, they're just so beautiful to look at. Now, I'm one of those types of people who sometimes I might hate a film, but I can admire its technical achievement. And I didn't hate this movie, guys. But with that said, it just had some really, really beautiful matte paintings. So Freddie Francis has an eye for just, you know, beautiful mattes and all that. And some of them just look totally great. I mean, I really, really love the matte paintings in this film. And I would say that these matte paintings are probably some of the best ever used in the Dracula films. Now, also we had James Bernard show back up to score the movie, and his score is very, very good. I really like this score. Now, of course, guys, you know, this film, as I've said before, wasn't directed by Terrence Fisher. But, you know, and Freddie Francis is definitely no Terrence Fisher, but I gotta give the guy props because he, I mean, given the screenplay that he had to work with, and the story that he was trying to tell, which is basically, you know, a retread of past stories, he did a decent job overall. I mean, the film had its weaknesses, but at the same time, in my opinion anyway, it weren't any less entertaining than the previous films. Now, also what I would say also, guys, is that this is a story in this film that, you know, the other films touched on faith, the power of the cross, and this and that, but I would say that Dracula Has Risen from the Grave even touches more so on the religious aspects of the vampire film. I mean, this story, you know, where you have, you know, faith not being in question in the previous films, in this film you actually have a character who's an atheist, and, you know, then you have a character who's a Christian, and it's kind of a nice balance to see the two differences of the characters, how, you know, eventually, you know, their beliefs cross path, and, you know, one has to accept the other, and the other has to accept the other person, and they have to work together to battle Dracula. So, you know, it adds for a pretty decent dynamic in a horror film, because, I mean, you know, in these Dracula movies, as far as they've been known, you know, faith was never a problem, but you actually have a character here who's an atheist, and it's just, it's kind of a rich dynamic to explore in the film. So you have a lot of religious elements in this movie, probably more so than any of the other Dracula films, and I think it's played and used to good effect. I think, guys, you know, looking back on the film from a historical viewpoint, Dracula Has Risen from the Grave is a movie that is definitely not as high rated as the previous films. As a matter of fact, even some of the Hammer fans do not like this film. I think it's an underrated film because I enjoyed it. I enjoyed the movie. I thought it was a fun diversion with just enough differences than the previous films to make it enjoyable. I mean, basically, it's a retread of Dracula, Prince of Darkness, where, you know, Dracula's resurrected, he returns, he's killed by the end of the film. So, I mean, you're not seeing anything new in this story, but at the same time, I enjoyed the characters, I enjoyed just the look of the film, I enjoyed Francis's take on the Hammer Dracula story. I think it's an underrated movie. I think it deserves a lot more respect than what it gets. Now, one thing about this film, guys, that it has the distinction of being the highest grossing movie in the Hammer Dracula franchise. And that's not to belittle the work that's come before it or after it, but it does have that distinction. It was a huge success. And much of that success can be accredited to Christopher Lee and Freddie Francis. The story for this one is that it takes place a little bit of time after the previous film, Dracula, Prince of Darkness. And remember, at the end of that movie, Dracula was drowned in this water and he was frozen and basically put in suspended animation. One of the weaknesses of Dracula in these movies is water. He can't swim. But in this movie, we see the little small town outside of Dracula's fortress and this little village that's always been there throughout the previous films. And the town is pretty besieged by fear and terror. Even though everybody knows Dracula is dead, they're still afraid. The stigma of his castle, the shadow of his castle looms over the town. It shines on the church. No one is worshiping. And the priest there has become an alcoholic, a weakness. His faith is pretty much gone. And one day we have Rupert Davies come to town. He plays the Monsignor, or really a priest, an overseer who checks on the churches to make sure everything's going okay. He comes to town, finds the church empty, goes to the priest and says, you know, why is no one worshiping? What's going on? And the priest explains, you know, the curse of Dracula looms over the town. The shadow of his fortress is on the church. No one feels safe. We feel his evil. It's still there. And the Monsignor is just like, you know, nonsense. Dracula's dead. You guys need to get on with your lives. And to convince the people that Dracula is dead and will bother them no further, he and the priest decide to go up to the fortress of Dracula and do an exorcism of the fortress to rid it of evil spirits and the presence of Count Dracula. So they head up to the fortress. The priest is so weak and besieged with fear that he can't go any further, so he remains outside, kind of like at below the mountains, while the older priest climbs up the mountains. And I gotta tell you guys, this priest in this film, one of the most wussiest priests I've ever seen. I mean, God, the guy is just really, really weak. But at the same time, you kind of can understand how he feels. I mean, Dracula has been haunting these people in three previous films. So you can kind of understand why he's so weak, why he's so terrified and all this. So he remains at the bottom of the mountain while the older priest climbs up to Dracula's doorway. He says his prayer over the fortress, puts this huge cross in front of Dracula's door, and he decides that the fortress has been cleansed. So he climbs back down. In the meantime, the priest that's waiting at the bottom of the mountain slips and falls into this stream, which is the exact same stream that Dracula was drowned in. It's dried up. He hits his head on the ground, and the blood from his head flows down into Dracula's mouth. Well, what a coincidence that would be. It's like, I can't believe it, man. I fell down and the blood from my head just happened to go in his mouth. But anyway, goes into Dracula's mouth. He awakens and he uses the priest as his lackey, as his slave, to do his bidding. He doesn't bite him. He just kind of hypnotizes him. The priest has this, he's just really weak-willed, and he uses the priest to do his bidding. So Dracula goes up to his fortress, and he sees this big cross on his doorway, and he's just really, really pissed off that someone has done this, who has desecrated his home. He says something like, "Who has done this thing?" And the priest tells him that it was the Monsignor. And Dracula vows revenge against the priest. He is going to kill everyone in his family and turn the Monsignor's beautiful daughter into his lady. Now, I could go on a little bit further, guys, but of course that would ruin a lot of the movie for you. But let's just say that it's a tale of revenge where Dracula actually seeks out this head priest and has plans to destroy him and his family. And I like the film, guys. I gotta tell you, I enjoyed Dracula Has Risen from the Grave. And once again, you know, Christopher Lee turns in an epic performance. He actually has a few lines in this film. And the guy is just terrifying as Dracula. And it's got to be one of the better roles that he's ever played in his entire career, even though he may not feel that way about it now. But Christopher Lee is just awesome in this film. Rupert Davies, who plays the older priest, just a warm character. I really enjoyed his character, just so fatherly. He just seemed like a guy you could just walk up to and tell all your problems to. Then we had Barry Andrews, who played Paul. He's the atheist in the movie. And like I said, guys, I thought that his character and the fact that he was an atheist was a really, really kind of neat dynamic. I mean, Barry Andrews' character kind of at odds with Rupert Davies' character. Just really kind of something kind of unique in a vampire film at this time that you don't really see. He's a very likable character in the film. Granted, all the characters in this film are pretty underdeveloped and all that, but I liked him in the film. But my favorite character would probably be Rupert Davies, the Monsignor. I really liked him in the film. So, you know, guys, while I enjoyed the movie, there are things in the film that, you know, were kind of silly. Like, for instance, when Dracula goes to his castle and he's just pissed off about the cross, he can't go in his castle, he's angry. You gotta wonder why he didn't just tell the priest to just take the cross off his door and then he go in. So that was kind of strange. Because later on in the movie, he tells a human character to get rid of the cross, and they just get rid of the cross and he goes in. So, you know, why wouldn't he do that in the first place? And I gotta tell you guys, Hammer continues its staple of beautiful women in this film. As a matter of fact, you see so many open bosoms in this film where you can just, it's just in your face in this film. It's not as coy and kind of teasing as it was in the other films. I mean, you see the big open bosoms in this movie. And, you know, that's not to say they look bad or anything, but they definitely are there. And we have Veronica Carlson, who plays Maria in this film, and she is... got to be one of Hammer horror films' most beautiful, vivacious women in these horror films. She's just a joy to look at, just a really, really beautiful woman. And just amazes me how Hammer is able to handpick these women, and they just look so seductive, so beautiful. They just kind of epitomize the femininity of a beautiful woman, and they just do that so well because... Veronica in this film is just simply eye-dropping gorgeous. Then we have Barbara Ewing in the film, who's another beautiful woman, simply gorgeous. Not as eye-catchingly gorgeous as Veronica, but definitely a gorgeous woman in her own right. So definitely the character she plays, whose name Barbara Ewing's character's name is Xena. And there's definitely a dynamic between those three characters with Paul, Maria, and Xena. There's kind of like a triangle. And I like this film, guys. I liked a lot of the fact that, you know, the characters were at odds with each other. I like the fact that, you know, the Xena character was jealous of Maria. They both wanted the same guy. And from the film, just from what you could see, you could tell that Xena had really had a bad time with men. She had never really found a man that loved her. Because when she met Dracula and was actually turned into a vampire, when he wanted Maria, she was still feeling that human notion that, you know, why do you want her? How come I'm not good enough for you? So, you know, it's not really all that different from the other Hammer Dracula films, but at the same time, there was just a few different elements in it that, you know, I found enjoyable. And I really like the cast in this film. And, you know, there's a lot of scenes that take place on the rooftops in these buildings where the buildings are connected. So Paul, who's an atheist, and the family pretty much rejects him and forbids Maria not to see him anymore. They sneak out to each other's windows going across the roofs. Now, I don't know how realistic that would actually be in real life, but, you know, in the film it works. And, you know, a lot of people, like I said, don't really care for this movie in the franchise, but I thought it was a really, really decently entertaining film. And I really don't get why a lot of people don't like it. But I enjoyed it. Dracula Has Risen from the Grave. I enjoyed this film, guys. As a matter of fact, if I were to actually put all the films in order, so far from the four that I have watched and revisited, I would say that they're probably in that order as to my desire, which one's better and worse. I like the first one, then the second, third, and then this one. And it's just got a lot of elements in it, guys, that work for me. The locations are decent. The sets are decent. The matte paintings are just gorgeously done. The cinematography, just beautiful to look at. Just a lot of things in this film that I really enjoyed. And it's definitely one that I remember the first time I watched it from years and years ago that I liked it then. And I still do. But anyway, that's it for Dracula Has Risen from the Grave, guys. I know it took a little bit of time for this next episode of the Hammer Dracula franchise to come out. A lot of people have asked me, hey, what's going on, man? You quit doing the Hammer reviews? No, I have not. But anyway, thanks for watching, everybody. Take care, and I shall see you at the next Hammer Horror Movie Review. Take care, and thanks for watching.